All right, so she okayed us to go ahead and remove the filter dryer, put a T in there. We're going to pop this coil up, fix that leak there on the TXV, and then recharge it back to spec, see where we're at, see where our pressures are at, and then kind of go from there. Told her there's a chance, you know, the compressor could be failing. Don't know yet, so let's go ahead and tear into it and get these things done. All right, so we've got a Trosslyn unit here. It's running 34. They said it's been getting, well, they thought it was getting warm, but it's been in defrost a lot. I'm kind of confused because they said it goes low on refrigerant. Usually every year or two, they have to add some to it. And it's running, obviously, at temperature. It was just in defrost. They said it seems like it goes in defrost a lot, so we're going to kind of investigate into it and see what we have going on.
It doesn't look bad so far. I mean, we're sweating really good there.
Yeah.
So you got a defrost control there.
Yeah, you've got one here. Ah, I wonder if this isn't even doing anything.
I wonder if this is doing all the work. Very possible.
So I opened the door, and temperature obviously rised up. I heard a click.
It's either thermostat or something. I'm not sure if it's the thermal overload because the condenser fan's still running. One easy way to find out whether or not this is what's actually controlling is just rotate it. See what we got going on here. Well, that obviously controls it.
That shut the condenser off. Now, it sure sounded like the compressor tripped out and it was not running. So I wanted to go off on thermal overload. There that is going again. 60 minutes, quite a long time. No termination. Pretty sure the thermostat's just inside the cooler here. All right, so it clicked and it came back on. Let's see if this thing shuts off. Ouch, good God, that's nice and hot. Let's see if this thing shuts off when we turn it up warmer. That way we can see whether or not it was actually a thermostat. All right, so the compressor shut off like it should have, and the fan shut off. So that tells me that it went off on thermal overload. And it's not very cold. It's definitely kind of hot here on top. I don't really want to leave my hand on there. So it's going off on thermal overload. This is a 134A system. As cold as that line is, I wonder if it ain't overcharged by chance. I don't know if somebody's dinked with it. Kind of hard to say right now. I don't see any liquid line taps to see what the discharge pressure is, which would help us to know whether or not it's got some issues with head pressure. You can see we've got pretty good light coming through, so it looks to me like our condenser coil is probably clean. We got our screws out of there. You can tell right there is probably where your leak's at. You can see where it's all dark.
Yep, right there's your water droplets, so right there's your leak.
Makes you wonder, why don't you just fix it? Let me see if we get any light through this evaporator. Evaporator looks pretty good. Okay, so what I end up doing is just stretching this across, made a little slit in that. Laid it down there. Need to go talk to him and find out what's going on with this thing. I'm going to scan that real quick, make sure that's where the leak's at. Detect 3 out here and see if my eyes are finding the leak where we think it's at. Should be right here. That was a real surprise. Okay, so the only place I'm seeing it is right there on that TXV right there, which could be very easily fixed. Just pop it up out of there and braze it shut. There's no filter or no receiver on this thing, so no way to pump it down to fix it. It's shutting off for some reason. Let's see what she wants to do, if she wants me to tear into it. I don't like this when you got unrelated issues. I mean, you've got a problem there that's been an ongoing problem that needs fixed. All right, so she okayed us to go ahead and remove the filter dryer, put a T in there. We're going to put a T right here, cut it in, braze it in. We're going to pop this coil up, fix that leak there on the TXV, and then recharge it back to spec, see where we're at, see where our pressures are at, and then kind of go from there. Told her there's a chance, you know, the compressor could be failing. Don't know yet, so let's go ahead and tear into it and get these things done. Go ahead and get this coil fixed while we got things going on here. We'll pull this thermostatic bulb out of the way. Get right to that and fix that. It won't be that bad when you set it where you can get to it. So you can see right there is where it's leaking at. Let's clean that up with a drill. And we'll rebraze that. That TXV looks kind of ratty too. Bulb, pretty nice if it was insulated. Yeah, whoever brazed that had no idea how to braze. What I end up doing is swedging my 4-inch line there. We're going to use the 052 cap TT dryer. Even though we're not using it for a cap tube, it's got good filtering in it. It gives me my ports. I figured this would be a little easier than screwing around with the T's. Go ahead and purge some nitrogen through this thing and get it prepped up and ready to go. There we go. You can hear it on both ports here. What we're going to do is we're going to add a little extra here. This area right here, that way we strengthen that wall up that we kind of got a little warm or stretched when we did the swedge on that. So we're just going to put a little bit across that to kind of strengthen it up a little bit. So. All we should have to do here is just heat it up, let it suck into the valve like it should have been sucked in there to begin with. It should be good to go. Yeah, whoever did this didn't clean it up very good. And that's the problem. Can't clean up very good. Yep. See if we can get this cleaned up. Yeah, it's really nice. Why you take the time to prep your work. Coil, you can tell, gotten really hot. Hell, it's probably leaking too, but who knows? This probably was a waste of time, but I'm just trying to do the job right. So I'm gonna heat this up first, then we'll heat this up and try to slide them together and see if we can get it to take. Probably shouldn't do this, but that piece there on that valve is starting to bother me quite a bit. let's go ahead and clean this piece of crap off here. There we go. 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 There. Got the big goober off there. All right, so we're starting to get it pumped up. Gonna do a pressure test here. I basically spray it down for leaks. Make sure that my solder joints hold, which I'm not seeing nothing there. Nothing there. And nothing there from what I can see. So we got that back into place. Put that down in there. All right, hopefully that'll work a little bit better than what it was doing. Probably was short cycling it, actually, is what was probably going on. That cold air hit it, because, you know, it was set for 35-ish area, and that air's gotta be 10 to 15 degrees colder than what you want the coil to be, if you ever hope to achieve it. So I made the defrost clock 45 minutes, spaced it out evenly because the clock's just gonna lose time eventually. About the only thing I'm gonna cut corners on today is I'm not gonna pull vacuum through on big monster hoses, if you wanna call it pulling or cutting corners. Half time you're lucky people even do it any other way than this here anyhow. Okay, we're not quite there yet. We just plugged it in. We're a little shy. I wanna see where we're at as far as head pressure and suction pressure, see if we're close. If we're gonna go into negative, if we're gonna have sky high head pressure or what, which the head pressure is already pretty high. TXV could have been screwed with, who knows. So I walk away for a little bit and the condenser is still running, but the compressor shut off. Superheat and such was in the 20, high and low 20s. We're not quite fully charged to maximum capacity. So unless that TXV is starving the compressor of a little bit of cooling, which I doubt, we probably have an inefficient compressor. So we're gonna check amp draw and see where we're at on that. It's a Copeland compressor, so we can check and see where we're at on the amperage compared to the spec sheet. All right, according to the Copeland app, 10.1 would be the max. We're pulling 7.2. Now, according to this right here, 10.1 maximum compressor amps, we're not pulling it, but yet it's tripping. Makes me really wonder about it. That's also including the amperage of the fan right there, because to get it separated, just ain't a whole hell of a lot of room right there. Needed a quick, easy way to find out. So we're gonna watch this for a little bit, see if she peaks up. All right, we're running 130 degrees on the top, so it's not horrible. So it might just be a matter of the thermal overloads getting weak on it, which I've never seen before. That's a lot cheaper than a compressor, but we'll give them an option for both, let them make their own decision. All right, so I just talked to the customer. There's the maximum hold, 7.1. So we're gonna order new start components. It's just basically cycling off. The box is getting a temperature, which is what they said originally, is that, you know, it is getting temperature. So, I mean, I would be very leery about putting too much money worth of food into it, but that might be our problem. I'm not 100% certain, but I mean, according to what I'm reading on Copeland's app, you know, that's about the best thing we can do first without jumping into big money. So we're gonna order this component. You know, like I said, we've seen all these things in the beginning, which is great. So I kept communicating with the customer, let them know, make them make the decisions. That way, you know, everything is in their ballpark and you've done what they want to done. And that way, you know, everyone's informed what's going on. So the best way to measure that is to do it at the compressor. But like I said, I know that fan motor pulls about an amp, amp and a half. So I'm well below.
3 days later.
All right, so it looks like it's sweating. Feels cold in here to me. That's a good thing. So it's at least been holding temperature while we were getting our part. There's the relay, capacitor, and the almighty overload, hopefully. Protector and clamp kit, wonderful. Light bulbs up here don't really do us a whole lot of good, do they? That's a great way to get something broke. A little less dangerous. There we go. I found a way to make this a little easier. We're just gonna loosen those up, pull that thing out of there. So none of this is the same. This is frustrating because according to the app, these parts don't even match up. I don't know if United screwed me or what, but the mounting for this is completely different than this. I checked with United. Your computer says it's the right ones. I said, what about the Copeland app? So he checked some other brochure or something. So he did find another protector, so they're gonna send that out. I'm gonna go ahead and wire up the new relay and stuff and the capacitor, get that on there for now, and then we'll go ahead and come back, unfortunately, for the other part. So is what she is, ain't much you can do about it. So we'll just change these connectors so that we can get it mounted on that relay. The protector, I mean, it's not a whole lot I can do on that. Looks like OEM. There you go. The resistor, I'm gonna go ahead and solder that on. Go ahead and stick these two prongs in there like that. All right, so we got that soldered into place. Good old Milwaukee soldering iron. Let's see if this thing will run. Can't really leave it like this, but at least make sure it doesn't trip out on thermal overload, huh? As you can see, it's kind of a tight spot back here. It should trip out here real soon if it's going to trip out. We're pulling 6.8 amps, which is well below the threshold. So we're at 37 degrees, still running just fine. I'm gonna go ahead and wrap this thing up and get it taped back up and put back in the box there. We'll come back hopefully tomorrow or Monday and swap that out. Right now I'm just gonna mount it inside the plastic box so it's protected, that way we don't have any shorts. The whole point on this one here was, do we condemn the compressor or do we think it's the protector? And it was the protector. We found that out by looking at the Copeland app and seeing what the continuous run amps are and what the maximum constant, the MCCA, maximum continuous current, is, and we were well below it. There was no reason for it to be tripping. So, like I said, these are the original start components. We replaced them all, and we're good to go. Well, they just shut off. They just reached temperature. Now, this control, like I mentioned, is not being used, but shut off at 37, and we're just using an old-fashioned analog control back there with a regular old analog defrost clock. All right, let's find out what's inside here as far as the condition it's in. So all that is the bimetal right there, and that little thing opens up and you can see it's kind of arced, not in the best of shapes, but that's all there is inside there, guys, if you're curious. That metal gets hot, opens up, just bends backwards. There's not much to it, but you can see that the overload's arced so many times from opening and closing that that definitely was a problem. So that's what's inside there.
48 hours later.
All right, so we're back again. This time we've got the corrected overload, which mounts right on there. Still don't think any of this stuff here works, but this will at least hold it in place. So it looks like we're holding temperature pretty good. We're in there at about 37, and it's obviously shutting off the way it should. So we'll get that thing in there, and then that's going to wrap this one up. So if you guys like the video, if you would, hit the like button, subscribe, check out Instagram and Facebook. And until next time, guys, we'll catch you on the next one.